Back in the 1970s, medical researchers had a problem. They were finding out the molecular basis of a bunch of diseases, which let them design drugs that could target those diseases at the source. This was super groundbreaking stuff. It's still cool. It's less groundbreaking now. Unfortunately, having a drug that works on paper and a drug that works in a human are two different things. The body is always on alert for stuff that doesn't belong there, so a drug has to get where it's going without the liver or kidneys or immune system showing at the door. One researcher had a bold idea. An idea so out there that no one believed it could possibly work. Here is how he proved them all wrong, and probably helped you in one way or another. This episode was made in partnership with the Kavli Prize. The Kavli Prize honors scientists for breakthroughs in astrophysics, nanoscience, and neuroscience, transforming our understanding of the big, the small, and the complex. In the 1970s, Judah Folkman, a cancer researcher, was trying to solve two small problems. First, he was trying to cure cancer, no biggie there, and second, he was trying to develop a system that would let a drug be administered slowly and evenly across a long period of time inside a patient's body. Compared with curing cancer, that second one might seem kind of in the weeds, but at the time, there was a huge appetite for that kind of system. That could offer long-lasting treatment for conditions like chronic diseases and allergies, things that affect a lot of people. And it could make those treatments easier to actually use. You could toss out that pill organizer because a slow-release device would be long-lasting. Plus, it would maintain more consistent levels of the drug in your body, meaning fewer side effects. The way we take drugs right now, it's always like spike and drop and spike and drop, and that's good for some, but not good for others. Cancer treatments like chemotherapy could benefit here too, replacing huge intermittent and toxic doses with a more consistent targeted option. And Folkman had some ideas about how to kill these two birds with one stone. For cancer, he knew that tumors were somehow making new blood vessels, a process called angiogenesis. So he figured a drug that could block that process, a so-called angiogenesis inhibitor, would suffocate the tumors and kill the cancer cells. But those angiogenesis inhibitors needed to get into the body somehow, and that's where he hoped a new drug delivery system could come in. It would need to release the drug over a long period, but it would also need to be non-toxic and not alert the immune system. Folkman's idea was to use a type of silicon rubber that was already being used in heart valves, shrink it to a centimeter and a half long capsule, and stuff it with angiogenesis inhibitors that would slowly leak out over time. Unfortunately, like many things that are attempted, it failed to act as a long-term device, and it didn't work at all for drug molecules over a certain size. Plus, he hadn't even found an angiogenesis inhibitor yet. And that's around when Folkman welcomed a somewhat non-traditional researcher into his lab. Robert Langer was an engineering graduate, yet he was eager to tackle these problems. Langer proposed some improvements to Folkman's idea. Like, he thought a centimeter and a half was way too big. He wanted to use a nanoparticle. A centimeter is a hundredth of a meter, a nanometer is a billionth of a meter. Basically, we're talking really small. Very, very, really, really tiny. Langer wanted to make a nanoparticle under 200 nanometers in diameter, because anything bigger than that would struggle to get through a cell's membrane and likely be degraded faster. Then he would stuff a drug into that nanoparticle, like a little water balloon. At the time, the idea of using nanoparticles was a pretty wild concept. They were notorious for being almost immediately destroyed by the body's immune system. Plus, scientists didn't think there was a way for substances to get out of the nanoparticle. Despite that, though, Langer was ready to try and figure it out. As for actually finding angiogenesis inhibitors, he started where every self-respecting scientist does: a visit to the slaughterhouse. He collected just tons of cow bones, hauled them back to the lab, then pretty much screened substances in them for anything that might inhibit angiogenesis. He identified around 100 candidate compounds to test, so next was to develop a nanoparticle to deliver them. When it was all fleshed out a little bit more, that became a polymer nanoparticle, which was essentially a ton of small chemical subunits called monomers, all linked together. In three dimensions, those links made layers with just a dizzying array of nooks and crannies, and Langer container could then stuff drugs inside this complex polymer maze. Scientists do love mazes, and not just for putting rats inside of. Over time, the drug would slowly make its way through the maze and diffuse out, allowing for long-term slow release. Using that method, Langer was able to steadily release drugs for over 100 days. Other improvements were made over time as well, like changing the charge of the particle to make it safer, adding a piece to the polymer to help it evade immune detection, and messing with the particle to keep it releasing the drug even as it eroded. And the team also ended up finding those angiogenesis inhibitors. So when another researcher approached Langer hoping to use his delivery system for brain cancer, Langer was ready. If getting drugs where they needed to go elsewhere in the body is hard, getting them into the brain is darn near impossible. The blood-brain barrier is pretty much the world's best club bouncer, keeping a whole lot of things, including cancer treatments, out of the brain. But maybe nanoparticles could slip through. Despite the valiant cause, Langer was facing an uphill battle trying to get this research funded. Like, the government wouldn't fund his work because they didn't think the polymers could be made, so Langer and the graduate student of his synthesized it themselves. Then, concerns were raised about how the polymer would react with the drug itself. After they solved that problem, funders worried it couldn't withstand the bodily environment, then that it would be toxic, then that it didn't allow the drug to diffuse far enough. Eventually, after all of this, Langer's team secured FDA approval for their method. Langer got patents for his slow-release technology, which he did not use to create a monopoly in the industry. Instead, he sublicensed to many companies, ensuring the technology could help as many people as possible. He also helped found several companies, including a little Boston startup you might have heard of. It's called Moderna. For their COVID-19 vaccine, they used a lipid nanoparticle to contain the mRNA, something that would not have been possible without the earlier research into polymer nanoparticles. So if you have had a COVID shot, you can thank Langer, indirectly anyway. And his research does not end there. Langer and a colleague created microchips that release treatment for osteoporosis and have been shown to work just as well as daily injections. His company has used this kind of technology to treat everything from type 2 diabetes and alcohol use disorder to schizophrenia and pituitary dwarfism. He's even been involved in developing treatments for Parkinson's disease, making an inhaled alternative to the traditional oral capsules. Langer has not only been involved in developing effective, safe treatments for many diseases, but he has also revolutionized the way that drugs are delivered into the body. He may have been working with tiny particles, but he made such a big impact that he was awarded the 2024 Kavli Prize in Nanoscience. You can learn more about him and his research at www.kavliprize.org. We'll be right back.